Happy Sunday. A couple of weeks ago, when the Pink Dot Movement had a gathering in Singapore during sermon time, I said that, you know, it may be necessary for me to speak on the topic of the gay movement, and it probably would take some kind of a special seminar for that to happen. But something happened on the 26th of June, which is just 2 days ago, that pushed this agenda a little bit forward. And so today I'm going to break away from our normal expository preaching on the book of James to take a topical break to give a response to this event that has happened. And I think that I'm not the only one who is doing this, probably across the United States of America and probably in many parts of the world, many pastors will be doing the same kind of work to give a response to SCOTUS. SCOTUS is the Supreme Court of the United States of America. This is the kind of abbreviation that they use. The other one is POTUS, President of the United States of America, the kind of ruling that was given. For those of you who don't read the newspaper, let me explain the situation a little bit further. The Supreme Court of the United States of America voted 5-4. There are 9 persons on the United States Supreme Court on June the 26th, 2 days ago, that states cannot ban same-sex marriage, which effectively hand the gay rights movement a historical victory. This is something that is quite unexpected, actually, at this point of time, but expected in due time, but unexpected, which is why there is a sudden need to address this particular issue. This is a most important milestone because it effectively declared gay marriage to be accepted in all 50 states in the United States of America. With one stroke of the pen, the five lawyers, as the Chief Justice called them, have legislated a lifestyle change in the United States. And the thing that is important for this is it also culminates the effort of the Barack Obama administration in pushing for gay rights. For those of you who know a little bit about the way the United States governance works, you would appreciate this statement a little bit better. The United States of America is a very odd entity in a sense because it has very complicated counteracting kind of forces between at least three parties. First is the executive, which is the president. Then you have the legislation, which is Congress, which is made up of Senate and the Congress itself, and the House of Commons. And then you have the Supreme Court, which is the judiciary. So the system is set up where the three triangles will all counteract with each other. The Congress makes the law. The Supreme Court decides whether the law is constitutional, and the president is to execute the law. And so the three will counteract each other in that the president has to be elected by the people, so would Congress. But the president gets to appoint Supreme Court justices, 9 of them, odd number, so that at any one case, the case will be decided one way or another. If it's even number, you're 50-50, the case is hung, right? So it's always an odd number. Supreme Court justices are appointed for life. They don't get removed unless Congress move in to, what is that word that they use? Impeach them. So is the president. The president is elected for a term of 4 years, and he has to be re-elected if he wants to have another term, and he can only have 2 terms maximum. And then the congressmen themselves can be not elected. So the three keep moving right around, and they all counteract and attack each other and bring each other into accountability. And the system is designed for all three parties to have equal power, so to speak. But however, because of the prominence of media and our attention towards celebrity status and all that, in the end, the executive becomes very powerful, which is usually the case for the President of the United States of America. So this role is often known as the most powerful role in the entire planet, to be POTUS, to be the President of the United States, because his appearance on TV or media and all that can bring about great changes, and he can lobby the Congress, he can appoint the Supreme Court Justice to steer the direction of the country to a direction that is pleasing to his own administration or to his own political party. And so that's how it works. And there's a fourth power will be the media. which is not written in the constitution, but it is quite free to attack anyone and to basically create a kind of a scenario as well. And so with all this, whenever a president is elected, he can bring about great changes because he can appoint Supreme Court justices, some of which are dying already. It also depends on whether they're dying or not. If they're all very young, then you don't get that chance. And you can steer the national agenda towards that direction. So in this, the rate of change in the matter of gay rights in America under Barack Obama is possibly historically unprecedented in its speed. Because when Barack Obama took office, there were only two states that recognized gay marriage. And now there is 50, which is essentially all of the United States of America. So within a span of less than 8 years, he has achieved what many, many past presidents, including Bill Clinton, attempted to do but has failed. And so in a sense, it's a very spectacular kind of event. So much so that when on the 26th of June this was announced, the White House lit up in this color, rainbow color, which makes me really angry because I am a fan of rainbow. And, you know, I remember the first gift I made for Patricia is a rainbow thing. Not so much for her, more for me, actually, you know what I mean? And you know, and I just love the idea that God would give us rainbow to display the colors. And you've seen rainbows on the sky. Unhappily, you got hijacked by the gay movement. And every time you see rainbow, I have rainbow watches and all that, rainbow shirt, and I cannot wear them anymore. You know, and that's what happened. And not only that, Newsweek then declared Barack Obama perhaps as the first gay president in one of the earlier days kind of a publication to indicate the kind of strong support that this man has towards the gay movement. The situation in the world today relating to how many countries have legalized gay marriage will look something like this. The blue-purple color are countries that allow gay marriages. And there's another small little light purple color, countries where gay marriage is legal in some way, which is Mexico. So from the map, you can see that practically all of the Western world would belong to that category. And the eastern side is still, except New Zealand, not in that kind of a role. Of significance are countries like Ireland, that is traditionally Roman Catholic. So a couple of months ago, they also legalized gay marriage. Now, so why are we so excited about this? Because there are so many countries that already accepted gay marriage, and some of which are very early in time. So what's the big deal about the United States of America declaring that all 50 states must accept gay marriage? This is because the status of the United States as the most powerful nation of the world would give this event and the movement added significance, more so than a country like Ireland or small little place like New Zealand or whatever. Because of the influence of the Americans towards the rest of the world, this particular event is going to be seen historically as a milestone, as a crossroad. Remember, I once preached about how every time in life we come to crossroads, right? Do we turn right? Do we turn left? Do we want to do the right thing or do the wrong thing? And the crossroads will then keep leading to more crossroads. And the course of your life's destiny depends a lot on the crossroads that you take and the decision that you have made. And so this is one of the major crossroads. 10 years, 20, 30 years down the line, historians or everybody is going to look back at the 26th of June 2015 as that one moment where major changes have occurred. Another parallel to this would be the case of Roe versus Wade, 1973. Supreme Court of America decided that abortion is to be legalized in all 50 states in Roe versus Wade. And that is also a major crossroad decision. Because from that time onwards, abortion by demand becomes something that all women has a right to access to. And it's a very odd situation too, because it created a situation where babies are aborted depending on which state that you go to at different time frame, whether it's first trimester, second trimester, and it's a very, very strange situation. For example, if you decree that a child or a fetus can be aborted at the second trimester, how many months is that? Do you know? 6 months. So 1 day before the 6th month is up, you can abort the baby. and one day after the 6 month is up, it will be considered murder. It's a very, very odd situation. And if you do not want to abort your baby and your baby is premature, one day before the 6 month is up, all the doctors will try their very best to rescue the child that is born prematurely, right? But another woman could walk in with a baby exactly the same age as yours and get it aborted and killed in a very normal kind of way and accepted. And that's how momentous decisions like this are made. And this particular situation is so unknown, actually, and the situation moving forward is so wide that it is expected to impact religious institution, educational institution, cultural norms, insurance, healthcare, etc. Not only in the United States of America, but all the way to Singapore and the region as well. Because the entire mindset of the world will begin to move, and implications relating to the legalization of gay marriages will impact many areas in life. For example, if you run a Christian school, it means that you have to teach gay marriage as a norm or an alternative form of lifestyle. You can't even use the word alternative anymore because now it's legalized. So St. Andrew or ACS or St. Margaret, or this Christian school, Catholic high school, you know, you have to teach when you do social studies or whatever that among the marriages, gay marriage is one of them. A children's book, instead of your regular children's book between a man and a woman as father and mother, you can now have children's book with a man or a woman and tell stories along that kind of a line. And people are asking whether pastors will be asked to bless or to conduct same-sex marriage. And you know, America is a very litigious society. In other words, people sue. And this is one of the reasons why this is the passageway to get around the whole idea of implementing this. And that's through the Supreme Court. Because once the court legalized something, then from top down, the whole situation is being enforced, right? So therefore, if gay marriages is legal and your church refused to conduct it for me, then you are doing something against the law. Then, of course, you are protected by the first, I can't remember which amendment, that guarantee religious right. But it is not an exact absolute thing. Because, for example, the Muslims in the United States of America do not get to marry four wives, although it's part of the religious faith. In Singapore, they can, but in America, no. Because the law of the land override your so-called religious freedom in some way. So the way moving forward will get very complicated. And the ripple effect of this ruling is still not entirely understood, actually. And there are new developments that are happening all the time, some of which are quite intriguing and not thought of before. For example, the emergence of the transgender emphasis today. A couple of weeks ago, I spoke about Bruce Jenner, the Olympic champion, decathlon champion. Super macho guy now is Caitlyn Jenner because he decided to have boobs and remove certain part of his body. I don't know whether he did that or not, but anyway, he's now supposed to be a woman. And what is the implication of that kind of thing to the society? And by the way, Barack Obama supports transgender situation as well. What does it mean to his children, to inheritance, to law, to alimony, to a lot of things that's coming around? And it's quite fascinating. I read a head of a psychiatric unit of Johns Hopkins University writing a comment piece on this. And he pointed out that actually a lot of you are celebrating this Bruce Jenner situation, Caitlyn Jenner situation, as a human right triumph. And the head of psychiatry of Johns Hopkins University said, in his opinion, it's not. It's a mental disorder. Because here you have a man who is looking in a mirror, and instead of seeing a man, he sees a woman. And so this psychiatrist say that something is wrong with the processing of the mind, because it's similar to a person who has anorexia nervosa, which is the disease that none of the women here have. So, you know, when you are skinny like a skeleton, you look at a mirror, instead of seeing yourself being skinny, you see yourself as fat. And so therefore, you don't eat anymore. You try. I see some of you doing this. Is it one of you are like this? And it's a serious mental disorder, you know, when that happens. Because instead of seeing yourself for who you are, you are saying something else. And you know, when you expand the argument further, you can even be applied to homosexuality. So that's a new intriguing area. I wouldn't use the word interesting. Intriguing area that is emerging, where transgender identity is a new area that people are looking at and thinking to themselves, what does that mean in the development? One other area that I find interesting is children who have been adopted by gay couples, there are cases of them suing the orphanage or the adoption agency. Because if I'm in an orphanage or a place that's supposed to take care of me, and a gay couple come and adopt me, whether they are two women or two men, then I, as a little child, will have to follow, right? I mean, they become my new parent. And they are suing because you are depriving me of a normal childhood where I get to grow up with a father and a mother, a man father and a woman mother. And now, because I'm a little child, I got no choice. I have to follow you when you say you adopt me. I'm forced to grow up in a lifestyle of two parents who are both mothers, no fathers. Or both fathers, no mother. And so I will be deprived of a father figure in my life by force, or a mother figure in my life by force. And who made this happen? The adoption agency. So I'm going to sue you because you forced this upon me. Now, anyone who has studied psychology, even at the entry level, know that the presence of a father figure and a mother figure in a family is an important situation in a normal situation, right? And even in the counseling that I would do and the pastoral that I would do, you can trace a lot of problem primarily, actually, to the lacking of the father figure in a family. And so you can imagine that if you are adopted by a lesbian couple, for example, and the lacking of the father figure is already there, yeah, I think it's a legitimate cause to sue someone because you are being forced to undergo that. So the implication is still developing as we speak. This is why I find it important for us to address this issue and for the people of God to understand what we are talking about, because the world will move very, very rapidly. The whole situation will permeate into your movies, into your drama, into your comedy. I mean, it's already there right now, but it will take on added speed now. Instead of something that people want to laugh about, it will be normalized, it will be institutionalized. And that is why the people of God need to understand their arguments. And why do we take on the position that we take? Now again, I'm going to be able to do pretty broad stroke kind of discussion because this is a very complex issue. So I have to admit that there are many things that I will miss, maybe many things that I will get wrong. But I thought it important for us to think about this issue. So with this as a very broad background in mind, let's come to the Lord in a word of prayer and prepare our hearts. Let us pray. We want to thank you, God, for calling us out of the billions of people in the world. We want to thank you, O Lord, also for giving us your word, the lamp unto our feet, a light unto our pathway, that in this world with 1,001 voices, the fallen world that is dark indeed, you have given to us the ability and a way to see your truth, for you declare yourself that you are the way, the life, and the truth. Help us, O God, to understand and to appreciate how wonderful and privileged it is for us. In this darkened world, you have called us also to shine like stars in the universe. For your name's sake, give us the courage, give us the wisdom, give us the mercy and love we need in our hearts, that we will always be your witnesses in the world. That whenever people look at us, they will then give glory to the Father in heaven. Have special mercy on your unworthy servant. May the words of his mouth and the meditation in all our heart and mind be deemed acceptable in your sight. For you are our God and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, I want to start off by helping us understand what are the key situation with the homosexual lobby and the homosexual argument. I think that there are many arguments, but if you break it down, there are typically a few big ones. First of all, you have arguments from the secular world, which is the non-religious world, because there are churches that would argue for it. For example, for a while, the church underneath my office is Singapore's only gay church. Openly gay church, the Free Community Church of Singapore. So those churches have their own argument, which I'll touch on later. In the secular argument, one of the strongest arguments is a DNA argument that we are born this way. And so Lady Gaga wrote a song, right? I'm born this way. And it is a very strong kind of endorsement. And even in Singapore, political leaders are persuaded to believe that the people are homosexual because they are born this way. And the illustration is always used, I always use, is like you say that I'm born with black color hair. And so I can't change the color of my hair because I'm born this way. This is one of the big arguments that has been around for many long years. However, in recent years, the shift has moved from a DNA argument to a freedom of choice argument. Freedom of choice, freedom of lifestyle, the idea that each should be allowed to live their own life. And we do see the argument moving away from this DNA thing because it's quite difficult, near impossible, to prove a DNA case because you've got to locate a gene that trigger off. And so people have been moving towards the second kind of argument, which seems to be the prevalent argument in the world today, that we live in a world where we should be free to love whoever we want, to live whatever lifestyle we want, for so long as it doesn't hurt another person. And I see this argument everywhere, including my friends who are on WhatsApp all the time. From time to time, they pop up and say, why are you making all this noise about whatever it is? It didn't hurt anybody. Everybody's happy. So long as you're happy, you don't hurt anybody, that's fine. And in this particular kind of a climate, people like us, who have something to say with this, the inability to accept anyone for who they are would be considered to be intolerance, discrimination, it's bigotry, you're ignorant, backwardness. For example, Hillary Clinton quickly seized on the opportunity of SCOTUS' announcement and said, hey, the Republican Party is a party of the earlier age. You know, because this Barack Obama is a Democrat and Hillary Clinton wants to be the next Democrat, first woman president. So quickly attacked the Republican Senate because a lot of Republicans are against gay marriage. So immediately, these people are backward. Anybody who do not support gay marriage or gay rights are backward. You're ignorant. You live in a stone age, right? And so these are the labels that are placed on us. And alongside with all this, of course, are the whole army of activists that will promote this in a secular world. And one of the reasons why this is moving so rapidly is the prevalence of social media, the endorsement by celebrities. And that's a very big thing. And we live in a celebrity culture, right? Sometimes I read the newspaper, I don't quite understand this. People, every little bit of thing that the celebrity do, they quickly put on the newspaper. The Chinese, you 放个屁 also, you quickly write down this. Wang Junqiai 放屁. People are so bored. And so when a celebrity endorses this, it becomes such a big thing. Now with this announcement, you see social media going into full play. A lot of my friends changed their Facebook thing to a rainbow color one. Now I know who is gay, who is not gay, because, you know, and some of them come out and took picture with their gay partner. I was showing Patricia, one of my classmates, you know, with gay partner, they're coming out. And some clowns don't know what it is. They just change their picture to a rainbow thing, just, you know. They don't know what it's all about. They just do it, kids and all that, you know. And it moved very, very rapidly and further reinforcing the idea that this is my free choice and that this is a new thing, this is a hip thing to do. And those who don't are just people who are most backward. And so generally, in the secular argument, it falls generally along these two great arguments. But the one that is more fascinating would, of course, be pro-homosexual Christian kind of argument. And you need to know this, because when asked, you will be quite surprised that there will be many people who say they are Christian and they support gay rights. And I have had many long discussions with many such people, including some of the church leaders. One of the key arguments is that whenever the Christians say that the Bible considers homosexuality a sin, it is an interpretation kind of a differences, that whenever the Bible talks about homosexuality or anything relating to homosexual sin, they are actually talking about temple prostitutes, not a monogamous gay kind of relationship. In other words, for a pro-gay church, the idea is that the Bible does not condemn monogamous, that means faithful, gay relationship. The Bible condemns promiscuous relationship, especially those relating to the use of temple prostitutes, which are a thing that happened in the early church. Another argument is that anything relating to homosexuality in the Bible is part of Pauline bias. Pauline bias means that it's a bias because of the Apostle Paul. So in the scripture text that I chose today, Romans chapter 1 is written by the Apostle Paul, and the words are very harsh and very tough, but it's because of him. You know, you don't see too many people in the New Testament writing about it. Actually, there's one other person, but most people would then say, ah, this Paul, because of his whatever circumstances that happened, and he is the one who hate the gay people. You don't see other writers writing about it. And not only that, you Christians like to point out homosexual sins, and you forget that whenever the Bible writes about homosexuality, it links with it many other sins. And so you want to focus on this one sin and catch us on it, but you ignore the sins of pride, you ignore the sins of hypocrisy, you ignore the sins of lust, you ignore the sins of not helping the poor, of arrogance and all those things. You let the rich exploit the poor, and yet you go after us just because of this one particular sin. So all you guys are hypocrites. It's a very strong argument actually in this particular case. And also, sometimes they bring out the idea that Jesus Christ never mentioned once about homosexuality. So again, it's a Pauline bias, because in the teaching of Jesus, he never mentioned about homosexual sexuality at all. And at the same time, Jesus is such a nice guy, such a loving guy, and you know, he would love wins. So one of the hashtags is going very fast in this SCOTUS thing is love wins. This Twitter is trending this very quickly. And this is one of the direction. The other direction is to simply challenge the authority of the Bible. Because you are saying that the Bible says that homosexuality is wrong, but the interpretation is quite different from us. And one of the more fascinating way is to challenge by using the Wesleyan quadrilateral definition of truth. This is by John Wesley, the person who started the Methodist Church. John Wesley said that, you know, when you want to understand the truth, there are four ways you should understand it. Number one, scripture. Number two, tradition. Number three, reason. Number four, experience. Now, I learned of this because of the transgender person who runs the church beneath my office, Sally. Sally is a transgender person, not her real name, so that you don't find out who she is. And but we are good friends, actually. She every time we see each other on the elevator, Sally said, I pray for you. I said, I pray for you also, you know, pray for each other. And Sally came out one day with a whole stack of reading material trying to convert me, you know. And I said, oh, let me get Stephen Tong material, try to convert you back. And we had good conversation about their theology. And in one of the literature, the church, the pro-gay church, talk about why they believe what they believe, and they use the Wesleyan quadrilateral definition of truth. So as far as they are concerned, when you want to know the truth, the Bible is one source, right? At the same time, the tradition is also another source. The way the church behaves is another source. And reason is one more source. And last one is experience. And so I may even concede to you that the Bible says that homosexuality is wrong. However, at the same time, the reason tell me that times have changed, that people are different, and that maybe in the early days, they don't understand how I really feel as a homosexual man or a woman. And then experience, I have a very enriching homosexual relationship with someone, and this sort of love is better than some of your heterosexual marriages where marriage sucks and what have you. So we are happier than you. And so the experience affirm that this is the new truth. And so therefore, I can deviate from scripture truth. Now, I want to clarify this. When John Wesley said that there is a quadrilateral definition of truth, he meant that scripture is always number one. And in order to understand scripture better, you can look at tradition, reason, and experience that will affirm scriptural truth, not to challenge scriptural truth, you know. But it has developed to such a stage today that many people are saying that this is just one of the four things you want to think about when you try to find truth. And so when you find that your experience doesn't match with scripture, it means a new truth has come. And so by this definition, then anything goes. You can have any kind of new theory, any kind of answer to as to how you should live your life. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, so what exactly would be our response to all this. For the Reformed Evangelical Church, it's always sola scriptura, which is the Latin phrase, by the Bible alone. For us, this is the supreme call in faith. And this is the key contribution, I think, of our senior pastor, Dr. Stephen Tong, in his entire ministry. And that is to call the church back to the Word of God, sola scriptura, that we will uphold the Word of God as the ultimate and the highest authority in life because of the revelation of God given to us in a fallen world that we live in. And so I have always mentioned to you that for us, the way we approach life is always looking at what the Word of God says first. And then after that, figure out what is it that we have gone wrong. And so, as I have always told you, if you feel that God is far away, guess who moved? You are the one who has moved, not God, you know. And so if you feel that, oh, you know, this is quite different from what I feel and what the Bible is saying is kind of inconvenient to me, guess who is wrong? It's not the Bible, it's you. And we have to understand faith in that way. And so when we think about this issue relating to homosexuality, from the entire general principles of the Bible and from the teachings of the Bible, I will tell you this morning that it is not as simple as saying, this is wrong, this is wrong. This act is lousy, this act is not true. Not so simple. You need to understand the basis of it all from the entire first principle of the Bible. In sola scriptura, by the Bible alone, we want to look at what sexuality actually is all about. Because the crux of the matter is a definition of sexuality. Not just about whether one act, this act, that act is right or wrong. It's not a quantitative thing. It's a qualitative issue. And this is a statement of faith as well. Statement of faith means that it's not something that you can be proven in a lab. Or you do some experiment, you can make it happen. It is a statement that we are saying, and it is affirmed by reason, by experience, by tradition, as John Wesley pointed out. However, it's still a statement of faith. We are proclaiming that we believe in the Bible, we believe in the Word of God, the revelation of God. And we affirm the rest of our life position from there. From the Bible, we see only one model for sex in the Bible. And this is a statement of faith. Because everybody else is thinking, you are crazy. Why should there be one model? There can be many, many models. We can have many different sexual experience. Sexuality as a lifelong kind of experience can differ from person to person. You talk to any sociologist, psychologist, they will give you 101 different kind of model. Our statement of faith is that we believe the Bible has only one model, and that is we believe sex is designed only for a monogamous marital relationship between a man and a woman. So the words highlight in yellow is the only model for sex in the Bible. The only model of sex that God has designed for humanity. Other than that, there is no other model for sex. Therefore, based on the design of God, then all other model for sex is sin. Premarital sex doesn't make this because not marital. Extramarital sex, monogamous between a man and a woman together. Sex with a man, it doesn't for a man and a man, it's between a man and a woman. Sex between a woman and a woman, sex between a man and three women. You get my point. There's only one model. So it is not just an issue relating to homosexuality per se. It is an issue relating to what God has designed sexuality for. For a person between him or her and this other person that he or she has entered into a marital relationship. This is the only model that the Bible has for sex. And so all other model, again, as I said, it doesn't matter whether it's homosexuality, whether you go visit a prostitute, whether you have a one-night stand, whether you have sex with your girlfriend or boyfriend before you're married, they all fall outside the model of sexuality as designed by God and is therefore sin. The Bible is extremely clear about this, and the Bible portrays a very intimate and very, very sophisticated idea relating to the design of God. So every couple that come before me to have marital preparation course, I will always start with Matthew chapter 19. Because this is where Jesus Christ talk about what marriage is all about. And so the homosexual lobby is wrong, at least on one count. While Jesus did not specifically speak about homosexuality, for here, by defining what marriage is all about, he is out ruling out homosexuality and homosexual relationship immediately. Jesus was asked, of all people, by a lawyer. Any lawyers here? Lawyers very sharp, huh? They always ask sharp questions. Not necessarily mean that they want to do it, but they ask. You know, when I was doing fundraising, Patricia was pregnant at that time with Suyin, and I was doing fundraising for community chairs. And if they asked me to go speak to a bunch of factory workers, I would be very happy because they will give. The idea is to get them to give monthly money to the charity that we represented. And then the challenge for factory workers is you have to tell the ama and the akong that, hey, you know, when you sign up, this is every month, you know, you have to give. Also, don't anyhow put $40 or $50. You better count carefully. And none of them ever say, oh, you're sorry, I put up 10 more, don't have. But when I get notice that I'm going to go to a law firm, I'm always very disappointed. Because the lawyer will gather together, ask you 1,000,001 questions, and then they don't give. It's always like that, you know. They ask you, where is the money going to? Are you on commission? Why is your wife pregnant and still here with you distributing newspaper, this form? How? I'm sure you're making money, right? You won't do this for free, right? It cannot be, right? I tell you, that's why one of my daughter thinks she wants to be a lawyer. So anyway. And what is marriage all about? He answered, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female and said, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold on to his wife and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let man not separate. And I always explain to the couple word by word, step by step, what this whole revelation of God means. Especially the last part. This last part is added to the original text that Jesus quoted from Genesis. And that is in Genesis 2:24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Jesus said, from the beginning. It means that from the very onset of design, God has designed marriage for that purpose. And there's so many things to say about Matthew chapter 19, and for today's purpose, we're focusing on the idea that Jesus said that the two shall become one flesh. Not only that, it's God that put the two of you together, elevating the whole idea of being one flesh to a God-linked situation. What Jesus is saying is that sex is not just simply biological, you know. It contains the divine. It contains the divine purpose, because God has put the two persons together. And we see that in other portions of Scripture as well. Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul quoted the same thing. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and the mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall again become one flesh. And this one flesh concept is elaborated in the Bible in most marvelous way. The Apostle Paul also wrote in 1 Corinthians 6:13 about being one, having sex with a prostitute or with someone who is not your spouse. Food is meant for the stomach, stomach for the food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Or do you not know that he who is joined with a prostitute becomes one body with her? For as it is written, the two shall become one flesh. You know, there is no other scripture, religious scripture in the world that describes sexuality in such intimate terms. Jesus Christ said the two shall become one flesh. He said it twice, you know. And contained within this is the great design of God for sexuality. And sex, therefore, is the most intimate interpersonal relationship and experience that God has given to mankind. no other experience rivals that. And I always tell couples that come before me that no one will know you more than your spouse, not even your parents, because God has designed this to be physically, emotionally, spiritually, for two persons to share a life together. And it involved the sexual act for the intimacy only found in a heterosexual relationship. And this relationship is to be a committed, faithful, and a loving one for life. And it is a beautiful relationship, but it is a statement of faith. Because how would you know? I'm not saying that anyone who has prior sexual experience before their wedding is to be condemned to hell and all that. That's another topic altogether, right? Because we believe that for whatever the case is, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. But assuming that we are talking about a situation where people of God have been following the word of God all their life, standing before me as a solemnizer will be two persons who have never had sexual experience before. Am I right? With anybody else. And now they are entering into a relationship where the sexual experience is to be had between a man and a woman in a monogamous, lifelong committed relationship. And I, as a pastor, servant of God, is telling you that this is designed by God. Even physically, isn't it? Sex between a man and a woman. Biologically, you're designed in a heterosexual way. And I'm telling you that this is, as Paul says, a great mystery. The greatest gift of God. The scoffers will say, are you crazy? How would you know? You only would know this one person. You know no one else. How would you ever know? Shouldn't you go out there and try first? Which is what some people think they should do, right? Before you get married, let's have sex first. Try it out. Are we sexually compatible? No. Then, okay, another one. By the way, are guys like that the best? Not sexually compatible, change partner. How? You will never know. The answer is, this is a statement of faith. We believe. We believe that this is so. And of course, as John Wesley pointed out, the other aspects of life confirm this to be the case. When you are monogamously committed to another person, faithful, you are talking about a situation whereby you don't have to worry about whether your spouse has some funny disease from somewhere, or whether or not he or she has loved someone else or had enough to go to bed with another person. You know what I'm saying? That commitment and that trust towards each other ought to be so close in a lifelong manner that those people who don't do this would never ever understand. And so this is a statement of faith that sexuality is the most intimate gift given by God for His people, and it is designed for a heterosexual situation, not that. And so therefore, by design itself, it then moves forward to other areas. The heterosexual family, therefore, is the basis of human existence, with procreation possible only in a heterosexual relationship. Am I not right? That it is impossible that if you have two men living together, they will produce a baby. Or two women living together, they will produce a baby. It is not possible, because God has not designed it that way. Now, I know that Ricky Martin has a pair of twins by surrogate or whatever it is, but that's not what a real life kind of a family upbringing should be all about. And it has to do also with the healthy growth of humanity associated with a male and a female being part of the parenting experience. And this is the way God has designed the world to be. This is the crux of the matter relating to homosexuality. For it violates the very design of God. And anything that violates the design of God in due time, if not immediately, you will see the impact to the rest of the society. Having said that, the first principle of what sexuality is all about, let me make it extremely clear to you that from the Bible alone, no question whatsoever that homosexuality as a sin is clearly spelled out in both the Old and the New Testament. Leviticus 18:22, you shall not lie with a man as with a woman, it is an abomination. Leviticus 20:13, if a man lies with a man, male as with a woman, both of them has committed abomination and they shall be put to death. Their blood is upon them. This is a rule given to the Israelites as they were traveling in the wilderness. I'm not saying that today you go out there and kill them, you know, but in the sight of God, it is a sin as serious as that. Verses relating to homosexuality includes Leviticus 18:22, you shall not lie with... Oh, this is a repeat of the earlier one. Okay, one more. Deuteronomy 23:17, none of the daughters of Israel shall be a cult prostitute and none of the sons of Israel will be a cult prostitute for the purpose of homosexual act as well. Genesis 19, this is quite clear. In Genesis 19, in the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, the people got into trouble because the men of Sodom, both young and old, came to Lot's house and called out to Lot, where are the men who come to you tonight? Bring them out to us that we may know them. Know them doesn't mean, hi, how are you? Let's exchange business card. No. In biblical term, know means let's have sex with them. And Lot says, I beg you, my brothers, do not act so wickedly. So the Old Testament is extremely clear about this. And in the New Testament, as you have read earlier, Romans chapter 1, clearly, for this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passion. For their women exchanged natural relationship with those that are contrary by nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relationship with women and were consumed with passion for one another. Men committing shameless act with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. Paul was writing about the early Roman and situation, the early church situation, where homosexuality was rife. Some people speculate that that's the sign of a fall of an empire, when homosexual acts are open, institutionalized. History shows that the empire will fall soon, right after that. Now, that's another topic altogether. But clearly, without a doubt, Paul wrote that homosexual acts is considered a sin, not only a sin, but a grievous sin. And that's not just about gay, it's also about lesbian kind of a situation here. And 1 Corinthians 6:9, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexual immoral adulterers, a man who practice homosexual sexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, drunkard, revilers, swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. This is where the homosexual lobby get angry. We say, you never go after people who are thieves, who are greedy, who are drunkard, revilers, or swindlers. You only go after people who practice homosexuality. To a certain extent, the point is taken. But nonetheless, it's quite clear here that this is considered a sin. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, understand this, that the law is not laid down for the just, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and sinners and profane, those who strike their fathers and mothers, for murderers, sexually immoral, men who practice homosexuality, and slaves, enslavers, liars, perjurers, whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine. And that's one of the reasons why the homosexual lobby think that there's a Pauline bias, because these are mainly words of the Apostle Paul. However, as I mentioned, there's one other writer, Jude 1:7. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulge in sexual immorality and pursue unnatural desire, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire by the Apostle Jude. So, of course, Paul was not the only one. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this argument moving forward will be complex in nature. People will ask you questions. You yourself may have doubts about who say what, but there can be no doubt whatsoever that the Bible clearly, without a doubt, consider the homosexual act a sin. So if you cannot remember anything from this morning's sermon, you must remember that there is no question whatsoever, certainly from the angle of the Reformed Evangelical Church, the Bible clearly considers a homosexual act a sin. And so earlier, the sin is listed among many sins. So fine, it's a sin. So what's the big deal? It's a sin together with the greedy, the thieves, the people who are immoral, the cheaters, people who strike their father and mother. I hope that you don't do that. Sometimes I look at the toddlers, I don't know why you parents allow them to strike you. Some of your toddlers, you better not let me see them strike you in front of me because I'm going to strike your toddler. Cannot do that. You know, Bible says that these people will not enter the kingdom of God, okay, so don't play. So what's the big deal? Why bring out homosexuality? As Pastor John Piper says, homosexual sin now is about the only sin that's being celebrated and accepted as right. And this is why it stands out above all other sins. I mean, most people, whether they are Christian or not Christian, still believe that adultery is not very right. Am I right to say that? Do you know anyone who celebrates adultery? If both husband and wife celebrate adultery, they ought to go to IMH. Something wrong with them, you know. Most of us, most of humanity, whether they are Christian or not, still think that cheating is a terrible thing, right? I don't know. Do you teach your kid to cheat in school? I hope not, right? You get a zero, then I put a one in front of a zero. It works. I know one father who actually got very happy when his child cheat. You know, it's quite a terrible thing. He tells me that the child goes to school and give the kid 50 cents. And every day the kid come back without money. And then he asked the kid, so what happened? He said, oh, I lend the money to my friend. And the father said, hey, hello. How about you lend your money to a friend? Go and take back the money. Next day, the father come back with 80 cents. He said, why you have 80 cents? Because I lend 50 cents, I want him to pay me back 80 cents. I said, you pay me back 80 cents. You don't pay me, this will go on your face. And the other fellow gave me 80 cents. You know what the father said? Praise God, hallelujah, my son will be a great entrepreneur. Tell me this, you know. And I was like, I don't know whether to should slap the father or slap the son, right? We don't celebrate sinful acts. But as SCOTUS in the United States have done, and all the gay rights lobby in the world has done, we are now institutionalizing something which the Bible has declared as sin. And this is exactly what Romans say. So as we read in Romans just now, in verse 132, the Apostle Paul wrote, though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. So this is where the problem is, where something that the Bible clearly declares as sin is institutionalized now on the 26th of June 2015 in all of the United States of America. And it will soon be in your office, in your school, especially for those of you who work with American-related companies, will be part of the culture and celebrated as something that is right. This is why this particular sin would stand out above all. So let us heed the word of God. What other responses then should we know? I spent time listening to you, the biblical understanding, so that you know that at least your first response must be that the Bible declares homosexuality as a sin, and you know the reason behind it. Not just what to do, what not to do, but that sexuality is designed by God for the specific purpose of a heterosexual relationship from the very beginning. As God created Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. Yes, very good. By design of God Almighty, sexuality is done. That. At least you know that. So what other responses can we have? The only way the Christian or a church can accept the homosexual lifestyle, really, therefore, is for a person to reject the authority of the Bible, supreme authority. And so when I look at my Facebook, I know a lot of people who change their profile picture to the rainbow hue thing. They call themselves Christian, a lot of them, Roman Catholics, Christian, all that. And they say, oh, I'm very progressive. And they always use the word progressive, right? I'm progressive, meaning that you are backward people. I'm progressing forward. The only way that can be done if you reject the supreme authority of the Bible. If sola scriptura means nothing to you. My brothers and sisters in Christ, this we will not do. This is the Reformed Evangelical Church. This is what we believe. This we will not do. And I oftentimes think that we are at a crossroad, the same way Moses was at the crossroad when he came down from Mount Sinai and he looked at the people worshipping an idol made of gold. And Moses declared, you know, those who are with the Lord, come over to my side. Those who are not, you can stay where you are. I believe that we have reached that kind of a crossroad. This we will not do. We will uphold the authority of the Bible for so long as we belong to the Reformed Evangelical Church. The other responses we need to address will be some of the things that I brought up earlier. The idea that there is a DNA argument. as I said earlier, people are shifting towards the free choice argument because it has been a long and rough road to find a kind of definitive DNA indicator that a person is born gay. And it just seemed to be quite an impossible task. There are no definitive scientific evidence that point to the existence of a gay gene. One of the more interesting studies done is identical twins. Now, if you have a pair of identical twins, they are clones of each other, you know. They share exactly the same DNA. And it is found that in many of these cases of people who claim to be gay, they have an identical sibling who is not gay. So that is quite interesting, which means that it is not something that is made by compulsion. In Singapore, there's a pair of identical twins that is in the entertainment business. Two guys, one is gay, one is not. And the other one who is not is married with children. So this sort of DNA argument is very weak. But if it is true, I would say that it's a very strong argument. Very strong argument that I'm born this way and therefore I shouldn't be discriminated against. However, even if a gene like that is found to exist, we do accept it as part of our fallenness. In a fallen world, people are born with all kinds of defective genes, all kinds of issues. I know it sounds very cruel to say that, but from a theological angle, we accept this as part of fallenness as well. Now, I want to also put in a word about orientation versus act. In this matter, orientation is not the same as action. In other words, if you have a homosexual orientation, meaning you think that you are only attracted to men, if you are a man, or a woman, if you are a woman, the orientation itself by mainstream churches is not considered a sin per se. It is the action that came out from the orientation. A simple illustration will be the orientation towards anger. I mean, I think most of us are oriented towards anger one way or the other. That is very different from saying that I'm going to get angry and punch you in your face. When the action comes out from the orientation, now that's the problem. And therefore, many mainstream churches can accept celibate people with homosexual orientation. Celibate means that this person does not engage in the sexual act and remain celibate. Some people look at it and say, wow, you know, that's such a cruel thing. How do you expect people to have an orientation and not act on it? But by the way, this is also the expectation of heterosexual people as well, isn't it? That you are to be celibate unless you are in a committed marital relationship. So it's not that unusual after all, you know. It is part of the requirement of the church as well. So looking at the whole situation, the declaration, then people are getting into a state of panic, worried, and on the internet you see so many things happening, a lot of people gathering together, making statements and all that. So how should we respond further? I would say that passively, at least passively, for the people of God, we are not to be too surprised. For the fallen world is simply behaving naturally in the way it is. I don't know whether you know this or not, but the Bible actually has a very pessimistic view of the future of mankind. That we are not going to be going from shining world to another shining world as human beings progress. It's the other way around, no? Jesus Christ said that the world will continue to spiral downwards. And then finally, who will come back again? Our Lord Jesus will come back again. So the world left on its own will always be spiraling out of control. And in that sense, Singapore in due time will move towards the same kind of direction. But I do not believe that gay marriage will ever be legalized in Singapore. Not because of Christian opposition or whatever, but because of the presence of another religion, Islam. Gay marriage will never be institutionalized in Singapore because we are in the midst of an Islamic region which has zero tolerance to homosexuality, by the way. They will do horrifying things to you if they find that you want to institute something which they consider as haram. So ironically, we are sort of safe, not because of us, but because of other people. But the world will continue to go into a mess further than that. We also ought not to be too depressed because we really do not belong to the fallen world anyway. And in this Hebrews 11:13 and other verses remind us that we acknowledge that we are strangers and exiles of the world. Hebrews 11 is all about the great men and women of faith. We are strangers and exiles passing through the world, and because of that, we ought to be prepared for even more troubles ahead from the fallen world. Perhaps less so from Singaporeans and Asians, as you saw in the map, more so for American Christians, as they now plunge head-on into an unknown world where things are changing rapidly and away from the Word of God. But you know, one of the irony is really because for the longest time, the Americans are under the illusion that they are a Christian nation. If you read scripture carefully, you will see that all true believers are always the minority. The Bible predicts that if you want to walk in a pious way, you want to live close to Jesus Christ, you will be persecuted. And conversely, therefore, if life is very smooth, everything is fine, as Senior Pastor Dr. Stephen Tong always say, you maybe ought not to give thanks to God too much, because maybe God does not see you worthy as a person who will go through persecution. This situation actually surfaced the fact that Christians are aliens and strangers on the world, that the world will never understand us. The world will always think of us as weird. And so this is the destiny that we have called to. And on a very positive side, although SCOTUS seems very powerful and instituted this that will change the culture of the world, you must always remember that God is above all man-made laws. Some people point out to passages in the Bible that say that, oh, you know, we have to be obedient to the authorities, Singaporean authority, American authority, whatever. You know something? That only makes sense when the authority is obedient to God. Let that not be something that you're mistaken about. The Bible has never taught that we are subservient citizens of the world. Never. The Bible has taught that you need to obey authority when the authority is executioning the things of God, executing the things of God, then you obey the authority. When the authority is against God, of course, God is always above all man-made laws. We are first and foremost citizens of the kingdom of God. Then you are Singaporean or American or Indonesian or whatever it is. As citizens of the kingdom, the laws of God is above all else. Not only that, remember that the Bible says that you are to rejoice evermore because we are in the ultimate winning side. We are people of God whose destiny is already sure in the hands of God. And we ought to live our life in that way, certain of it. The Reverend Daniel Wong and me just came back from Xiamen, and he left a bit earlier, and I stayed one more day. Our preacher Chi Ling's grandmother passed away at age 89, so I spoke at the funeral arrangement. Mainland Chinese funeral is quite interesting. There's another story altogether. You know, picture is very big. And his mother, the father told me that, Chi Ling's father told me that, you know, my mother is a very ordinary woman. And I know the mother because I married Chi Ling and Priscilla. So I was there when they got married, and so I got to know the family well. Mother is an old lady who was almost completely blind. Guess what? She memorized the whole of the Psalms. You know what ordinary means? Ordinary means you throw a stone, you hit someone, they're all the same type, right? You know anybody who memorized the whole of Psalm? Make it easier. You know anybody who memorized one Psalm? Psalm 23, okay, one. Old blind lady memorized the whole of the Psalms, okay? So when I'm before, I better keep quiet, don't say too much, right? You know? And this person lived a life completely joyous and happy and help people. She's not a theologian or whatever, but she pray every morning. She lived a completely different life from the rest of the world because she's on the winning side. No doubt about it, the kind of victorious lifestyle that come out radiating from this one person who believed in our Lord Jesus Christ. And I was so touched by her lifelong experience and her example. And to some extent, envious, you know, because she seemed to be in her own world, and that should be what it is, because we are on the winning side. And so, in response to the world that is fast changing, I'll say that Chi Ling's grandmother demonstrated one of the key correct response, and that is you ought to live well and live strong. Be exemplary in your lifestyle, living a God-pleasing lifestyle that He has designed for us. And especially for those of us who are married, who are getting to be married, those of us who have family, you live a lifestyle pleasing to God in your family. You bring up children that love God. You love your spouse. In the way you say when you got married, no, I will honor you in love you in good times, bad times, sickness, in health, in wealth or in poverty. Whether the journey ahead is going to be rough or smooth. Till what? Till death do us part. Can you do that? Sometimes you think about it, you think that, oh, do the work of God means that I go to Africa and go and be a missionary. Or I'd be like Stephen Tong, have this great gospel rally. I tell you, not so complicated anymore these days. Just by maintaining a happy, normal, loving relationship with your spouse, with your family, with your children, makes you someone who will stand out in this very, very fallen world. And we need more of that. We need people to come together and live the life that God has designed for us. You know, sometimes when I solemnize marriage, I am moved to tears myself by the people who are coming together to make their vows. It's just a precious thing that God has given to us, for the people of God. This whole idea that I'm going to commit my life to you through the thick and thin of life. And indeed, life can be quite rough, right? As the preacher sitting and his wife Priscilla demonstrated emptily. But they hold each other's hand, they walk together. This is such a wonderful, wonderful thing that God has given to us. And I pray that you understand that. And don't go and go after the crazy stuff of the world and abandoning things that God has given to you as the firstborn. Live life, live strong, live well, so that the rest of the world that have decided to go against God will look at you and wonder what happened in your life. Why are you so happy? Why are you so joyous? And then as the Bible says, give glory to the Father in heaven. Towards people who have chosen a lifestyle that is not pleasing to God, remember always that we are to love even our enemies, let alone people who are sinners just like us. In the last song that I have chosen for you, we have a story to tell to the nation, a story of truth and mercy. The truth of God, coupled with the mercy of understanding that some people just have made the wrong choices in life, believe so much in the wrong choices in life, and they need mercy, not judgment. And so we are not out there to persecute people who disagree with us, but neither are we to compromise the truth of God. We need to stand firm with truth and mercy in our life. I saw this poster and I thought it makes a lot of sense. Ultimately, as the world keeps changing, you got to keep calm and continue to let your light shine before our Lord. We are certainly at an important crossroad in the history of mankind. I pray that every single one of us, made in the image and likeness of God, redeemed by Him. Earlier, Reverend Wong was talking about how He has redeemed us as we observe our Holy Communion. We are special people, called to be salt and light of the world, especially in this darkened world. I dare say that as we move forward, the world will get darker and darker, and so your calling will become more and more important. Think about this carefully, pray about this carefully, and commit your life to God. Be serious about your faith and be exemplary as salt and light of the world. Let us pray.